Hey and welcome in this video tutorial. I'm Aggelos and today we're going to see some amazing and very practical endgame. You are going to learn a lot. In this position is White's turn, so please stay with me and we'll see the game completely. The game played in 2019 in Moscow in December between Carlsen and Savchenko. I'm sorry if I'm pronouncing wrongly than the players. But let's focus on chess, right? So let's see the game from the beginning. So Carlsen had the white pieces and started d4, d5, knight f3, c5. I'm not commenting too much in the opening because this is not the purpose of this lesson. I'd like to highlight the most important thing. So e3, so he captured here on d4, he takes d4, knight c6, bishop b5, bishop g4. Both players correctly develop the pieces, and I know that the most of the people here may play something like c3 in order to go in this Carlsberg structure with reverse colors, something really solid. But Carlsen had another opinion. He tried to immediately open the position and create problems. Knight f6, knight c3, and now he should decide again how to play the game, right? And if he plays something like e6, then we may have this move, knight c5, and this is the Carlsen exchange variation, yes, Panov, but the Botvinnik variation. And now we can see that the black cannot easily play this move, e5. The bishop is little closed, we have this spinning here, and white have some advantage thanks to pawn majority in queenside. It's difficult to play with black, and here the black player played this move g6, h3, bishop takes f3, queen takes f3, a6 in order to liberate the knight. And now we have a little combination: c takes d5, knight takes d5, queen takes d5, a takes b5. The material is equal for the moment, and white can capture on b5, but black can recapture back the pawn on d4. Bishop g7, queen takes b7, and knight takes d4. And as you can see here, the knight on d4 is extremely active, like the Benko Gambit. Black sacrifice a pawn and he would like to have activity with his pieces, so the game is really excited. Short castling, rook d1 in order to pin the knight, and queen b8. So he keep the queen on the board, queen e4, and right now he's threatening to capture this strong knight, so you should not allow this with black. And black have another tempo here, f5. You see, queen d3 and e5, he protect the knight and he is ready to push forward his pawn majority in the king side, and definitely black here have compensation for the sacrificed pawn. And we can see that white have one extra pawn and two connected pawn in the queen side. However, he don't have good development, and it's really difficult or almost impossible to push forward these pawns, right? Rook b1 in order, a typical move like Benko, in order to liberate the queen side, in order to play something like b3, bishop b2, and develop normally the pieces. Queen b4, bishop b3, another idea to eliminate this strong knight. Rook fd8, and now we can see a lot of tactics. For example, right now black is threatening a check on f3 in order to capture the queen, right? a3, a counterattack. Queen b3 and bishop takes b4. Finally, eliminate the strong knight. Queen rook takes d4 in order to keep protected these pawns. This will be a strategical mistake because after that white can play something like knight b5, and the problem is that this pawn is blocked in the same diagonal as the bishop, and we have a fantastic blockade here on d3. And we offering the queen exchange, and if you go on the end game, then everything is clear for white and he can move forward his pawns. So it's very bad to capture here on d4 with a pawn. And black, of course, capture with rook. Queen b5, offering the queen exchange, rook b8, and queen c5. And you can see that grandmasters and strong players, they are extremely careful on how to exchange pieces. On Remote Chess Academy, we have a course about this, how to exchange pieces, and if you like to improve yourself, definitely you should study this course. The author of the course is Asaf Givon, a great international master from Israel, a really cool guy, and when you see his videos, of course you are going to learn a lot. I created some videos, more basic videos, of course, but the complete course is very nice in order to understand how to exchange pieces in chess. And in general, I'll give you a tip now, and so be careful. In general, you should exchange pieces under your circumstances. If this is beneficial for you, then you should exchange pieces. If it's not, then you should not exchange pieces. For example, if you capture here the queen, then black will create this very strong blockade here on the pawns, on the light squares. These pawns cannot be pushed forward. Then he can push this pawn on e4, and we have a powerful bishop. He can place the rook on c4, for example. Yeah, I can place some random moves in order to illustrate my point, you see. Something like that. Now you can see a lot of pressure on c3, on b2. White is tight down, right? Yeah, the position is approximately equal. White have check or something, but it's a little more difficult to play this position. And for that reason, Carlsen played this move, queen c5. He don't like to exchange the queens right now. His queen is active, and we will see, right? And now black offered the exchange of the queens, and now he accept the queen's exchange, right? But why he have done it? Because now we don't have this blockade on the light squares, right? So, knight d5, and as you can see, the knight is extremely active now. Rook b3, of course, rook d2, and now we have more freedom. He win a tempo in order to organize his pieces better. e4, when you have a bishop, then you should put the pawns in the other side of the board. This is Capablanca rule and very well-known rule. g3, very important pawn advance in order to blockade this pawn and create a stable base for the knight if it needs. It's king f7, very important to activate the king in the endgame. King g2, this is another really important move because we're totally protecting the king. You see, now bishop doesn't have any real opportunity to create any tactics or to give any good check. Rook d4, rook b to d1 is important to exchange again. This is a passive piece, and this is nice piece, an active piece. So Carlsen use this passive piece in order to put it in the center and create some pressure. Rook takes d2, rook takes d2, bishop takes b2, and this compensation and very good activity give some benefits to black. So he recaptured the pawn. However, the position is continued, a4. Bishop e5, rook a2. Carlsen managed to put the rook behind the pawn. Now he creates some problems to white, to black, right? Because white would like to push forward the pawn, and black should blockade this pawn. King e6, knight f4, check. Of course, if the bishop captures right now the knight, then it will be much more difficult for black to blockade the pawn. King d6, a5. Bishop a6, now he creates a very strong blockade here on a7, and similarly at some point, he not right now, but at some point you can imagine a black rook on the second rank, and he's putting pressure here on f2. So this bishop is powerful, right? Really powerful. And we cannot say the same for the poor knight. The knight is not really active right now, and he cannot help the advancement of the pawn. So a6, bishop a7, h4, in order to totally blockade the pawns, and he free the h3 square in order to create some maneuvers like that, f3, g5, attack the weakness on h7, etc. So e3, a nice move in order to create more freedom for his rook, and expose a little bit white king's position. F takes e3, rook takes f3, rook d2, king c6, rook c2. Important checks in order to put a question to black. Black should choose now where he should go. And knights create a lot of tactics. For example, now king cannot go on he can go here, but if he goes here, then this is another tactic. We are attacking the bishop and the pawn. And it's important to careful where you are going with the king, because at some point, not right now, but at some point we have a double checks, right? Something like knight d5. King d6, okay, rook c8. This is important in order to penetrate with a rook in the back rank, and now he would like to attack this piece. This bishop is powerful because it's blocking the pawn, and we have another idea to attack another weakness on the other side of the board. So white here have some initiative, right? And please also notice that this knight is very good defender because he didn't allow any good check on e2. So rook e7, king h3, bishop e3, rook d8 check, and king c7. And now we have the diagonal position, that now the game start becoming really exciting. Why? Because we will see how Carlsen played this game fantastically. Right now our rook is under attack, and now he played an extremely good move. Can you find it? Rook d3. Why this move is very important? Because we save the rook, we are threatening a double check here on d5, this is a check, and similarly we have another hidden threat. Another threat is to capture the bishop, and if the rook recapture on e3, then we have this check again. By all means, we threaten now with we don't give a lot of options to black and force black to capture this knight on f4. So g takes f4, and now we transpose the game into rook endgame. And what is the problem? As you can see, a little earlier in the game, we had a very good defender, a blockator here on a7, and white wasn't able to push this pawn freely forward, right? But now black should have one of his pieces, he should tie down off one of black pieces in order to defend this pawn. So king b6, rook a3, and now we are threatening to push, or not right now because the pawn will fall, of course, but we have this threat to push the pawn. And what should do? Black should play there the king. And now Carlsen played another fantastic move, h5. Why this move is very important? Because with tied down enemy pieces, they don't have activity, and we try to create weakness in the king side. And by creating weakness, then we can penetrate with the king and capture the pawns. And it looks amazing, but the position is approximately equal, right? With the correct play, it is equal. But it's very, very difficult to play this game in a practical board, right? When you face your opponent and when your clock is ticking. So he played this move, rook e4, and now you have to take a decision. What are you going to do now with white? Please pause the video and think. And Carlsen took the decision to sacrifice his beautiful looking pawn on a6 in order to win time and activate his king. So rook king takes a6, king h4, and of course now if black takes immediately on h5, what are you going to do now? This is another tricky moment. And you should play this very precise move, king g5, because the f-pawn is more important, and in endgame you should create a passed pawn. And after that, king b5, for example, we will capture here, rook e2, and we will have time, we have time now to recapture both pawns or to attack this h-pawn, this weak pawns. For example, king c6, rook takes h5, king e7, king f6, we are attacking the rook, king d7, and the rook perform his work here, and he can change sides now. He can play rook a5, and as you can see, white is very close to winning, because right now he's threatening to give a check on a7 and win the rook. The pawn cannot push forward, the h pawn. The other pawn on f4 is much more dangerous, and right now white can continue pushing the pawn, and black have problems, right? It's very difficult position. For that reason, black, a strong grandmaster, didn't capture immediately, of course, and he realized that it's very important to bring the king in the action, in the king side. So Another mistake here could be to capture immediately here on g6, because after that, king g5, rook e6, rook h3, and white should lose some time in order to win this pawn. And please remember that black is a pawn up, right? And after that, king c6, rook h6, king d6, we can capture. And after this exchange, king takes g6, king e6, we are just in time, because after king g5, we can play a very nice move here. Can you find it? King e7, and if the king's plays here, then we have this move, king f7. And on king g5, for example, we can wait. And yeah, my computer gives here advantage to white, but actually we cannot win. He suggests this move, but we play this, rook f7, and computers are stupid sometimes, and they're not very smart, and this is totally draw position, because white cannot win the game. In order to win the game, we should place the king in one on the critical squares. If white king managed somehow to have access on some of these squares with a green color, then white is winning. But here the position is draw, and so it's wrong to capture immediately here on g6. And of course, it's more important to activate your pieces. A very natural move, king g5, protect the pawn, free the rook, and right now he's threatening to capture immediately the pawn, right? The pawn on g6, he can capture it twice. So what to do? Rook e6. If he captures here, again the same variation, we can recapture on f5. And he played this move, rook e6, and now you have the opportunity to play a very nice move. Can you find it? And the very nice move here is rook c3, a very important rule to cut off the enemy king out of the real action. And now we are creating real problems to black, because the rook is very lonely in the king side. So rook d6, and here it's really easy to criticize the players when you stay in your home, when you have your computer open, it's okay. But when you are playing in a real game, it's really hard to find the best ideas. And here you have the opportunity to play better than Magnus Carlsen, better than world champion. Can you find the best move for white? And the best and winning move here is to capture immediately on g6. Carlsen played h6, another good move. The position is draw after this with correct play. It's or black have real chances to keep the draw. But the white's idea is to penetrate with a rook on the last rank. Rook c8, rook g8, rook g7, something like that, for example. And it could be extremely difficult for black to protect the h7 pawn. For example, you can see the plan in a minute. But if we capture here immediately, this is the best move, because of course rook cannot recapture, because we will capture this pawn on f5, and our f5 pawn is much more dangerous comparing to the h pawn. So another idea is to recapture here, but again we have this rook c8, king b7, and we are just in time now to capture the pawn. And as you can see, the black king is far away from the action. So this was the winning idea. Really difficult to spot it in a real game, and this you can see this game on internet with a real video. And as you can see, the players have a lot of tension, they don't have a lot of time in their clock, so it's easy to judge that he didn't find the best move. But this move was really difficult, and we should congratulate both of players, of course, and Carlsen, because he has a real plan, right? And if you have a plan in chess, this is really good. So rook c6, please remember that black is a pawn up, so we don't like to exchange rooks right now. So he played king e3 in order to illustrate it. For example, if we capture here, the position could be a draw, because we should go with a king forward in order to capture this pawn, but the black king is just in time. King g7, for example, king e6, and if we capture here, he will play this nice move, king f7, and this is a draw position. If we eliminate somehow all of these pawns, this is a draw, because white cannot escape from the corner, right? He can play here, and we can wait. If he plays here, again, we will play this move, and this is a stalemate position, because there is no legal move, and white king doesn't in threat. So king e3, Carlsen of course that doesn't like the draw, he would like to win the game, and for that reason he played rook e3, and the best move here was rook c7, a really difficult move to spot in order to overprotect the weakness on h7, and after king f6, the very natural move, again here we should play another extremely precise move, rook d7, in order to wait, and as you can see, if we play immediately king c6, then black white can immediately exchange the rooks, and the king, our king, is extremely active. This was the idea, right? And another idea is if he goes on b7 in order to go from the other way on c8 and come like that in the king side, we can play rook e6, rook c8, and here check, we can give a check. Of course he cannot play on d7 because we have the same variation as well. Check, and we can exchange the rook, and our king is extremely fast, and if we do it in the other way around, he can play like that, we have the Magnus idea, rook g8, king c6, rook d7. And now what to play? He can play something like that, rook d7, and now we have an amazing move, really amazing move. It's white's turn. What are you going to do? And the correct move here is rook e5, king e5, whoa, because after this one we will play king e6, and now we force black to do something, and we will win. And if we play immediately the nice looking move king e6, then he will play rook c7, and he's just in time, because if we capture the rook, he can recapture with the king, we can play this move in order to wait a little bit, but black can wait as well, and if we run to the pawn, then he can come after us, and after this we can see the same draw's position again. White king cannot escape from the corner. So this was just a long variation in order to see how complicated is chess, and after this move, rook e3, black played rook c4, a normal move, okay, what to do, but after that he plays immediately, and now he lost the tempo. Now we can see that Carlsen ideas work perfectly, king c6, king f6, rook d7, and now we have the same idea again, king e5, this is the correct move. Carlsen missed it in the game, but we cannot blame the players, as you see, it was just a rapid game, you see he played that, and here rook c7 was a nice move, but okay, black missed again his chances, and as Gary used to say, Gary Kasparov, when you make a mistake, usually you expect from your opponent to give back this mistake, to make a mistake by himself, right? And this is exactly what happened in this game. Rook takes h7, rook takes f4. It was very natural to eliminate pawns. Black is a pawn up, right? And it's natural when you are defending to eliminate some pawns in order to get closer to a draw's position. However, here we have rook h8, rook h4, h7, and we are threatening and check on h8, on c8, sorry, and after that to create a new queen. And you should be extremely careful here for black. For example, if you play careless in this way, king c7, now white have a very nice tactic. Can you find it? Rook a8, and if we capture the pawn, then we have this Turing attack, and after king c6, we will capture the rook. And of course, black is a very strong grandmaster, and he played a correct move, king b7. Unfortunately, this is the only move to stop white checks, and this tactical idea, rook a8 and check on a7, and again Carlsen with this magic way forced the opponent king to go far away from the game. King f6, f4, king takes d6, check, and king h5, we stop this check on h4, rook g1, and after this black player resigned, because he can give a check, and after that we will go forward. We are threatening again to deliver a new queen, and after this check we can hide behind this pawn. We can use this pawn as an umbrella, and black doesn't have any good checks. Rook h1, we will deliver a new queen, rook takes h8, rook takes h8, f3, we will stop the pawn, and after that we go after it and we can get it. So this was the game, I hope you enjoyed it. It was a long game with a lot of tension and a lot of ideas, and I should recall you this position. Here white played this very nice move, rook d3, in order to threaten the bishop and force the opponent to give up his good bishop. And another good move is here, rook f3, in order to activate the king, right? I hope you enjoyed this video. Please share it, press the like, and I wish you all the best, and I hope this video improved your skills in endgames. All the best!